first question, like the meaning and relevance of entrepreneurship has like significantly evolved over the years. Like over the years, how did you see it evolve, like in your opinion? I mean, how is today's scenario different from that of a few decades back, like in regards to entrepreneurship?
I think today is very heavily, common factor is it's innovative. Entrepreneurship stands for innovation. Entrepreneurship stands for problem solving. Yes. Entrepreneurship stands for creativity. That's the way it was. When Infosys and others categories came, they came as problem solving, they came as innovation, they came as creativity, and they were resource strapped. But they generated their own resources, like-minded people came and created those institutions, which we are all benefiting from, and how they put us on the IT map of the like the HCLs and the HPLs, etc. Or so you got so many names, which if you go back, we are all bearing the fruits of their creativity. So the fundamentals don't change. Today, on the contrary, you have more resources available. You have more experience available. There's more mentorship available. There are more schemes available. There are more venture capital available. There are more good angels available, which wasn't the case earlier.
Yes.
So that way it's evolved a lot, and it's also encouragement to entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
The risk remains, but now there's risk management and risk mitigation processes in place. So the ground for entrepreneurship is much, much wider.
So like, as we all know, you're the first female IPS officer in India. Like, that's a really great achievement. Like when did you know that you wanted to join the civil forces? Like, what was your inspiration? The decision.
My inspiration was love for working in the government.
Mm-hmm.
It shaped into having been a sportswoman, having been an NCC cadet, and also being very sensitive to injustice. Mm-hmm. And I found the policeman was the biggest protector of human rights, as he could be a violator. So for me, the positive side of policing was very attractive. And I was a very fit, stamina-oriented player, outdoor girl, good in studies to made it good, but also love for service through government, because I saw the power of the government to transform. Just as the power of the government, if not used, is status quo and it declines. But for me, I saw the positive side of governance, which is transformative, performing and transmitting, as the Prime Minister says. Even in policing, it was like instant justice. When I arrest a person who is causing harm and danger to society, I'm giving instant justice. Arrest of the right kind of person is instant justice, which attracted me. Whereas as a person who's a civil servant writes on a file, get somebody else to act on the file. I don't have to wait to act on the file. I see a wrong as a policewoman or officer in uniform, I have the power to immediately correct. So I believe in the power of instant justice. Not wrongly, but the rightly. That's when I knew where I was going. I did not have business in my mind. I didn't have the bank in my mind. I had public service in my mind. And that's what attracted
me. So like, our country has had many strong women leaders like Indira Gandhi, Sarojini Naidu, proving that, of course, women can be, you know, are equally, and if sometimes more than, you know, equally competent, like as rulers. So, but then sometimes there is still a negative perception in some places regarding women in authoritative positions. So, or women as political leaders. So, how do you think, like, we can change this perspective of the society, like, as a whole?
Look, every woman's life's preparation journey is different. You mentioned Indira Gandhi. She was groomed to be a political leader. Her father groomed her. Pandit Nehru groomed Indira Gandhi. Sarojini Naidu was a product of the freedom movement. And she was a part of the Mahatma Gandhi's freedom movement. So they were groomed women. I've noticed that when you have a groomed woman, she creates her own reputation. And if the reputation is positive, the amount of greater respect and regard she gets from the public is unparalleled, because they earn the trust of the people. I think it's the other, where man or woman, the reputations precede you, man or woman. So I think it's not a question of man or woman, it's a question of grooming. If you've been groomed and you've earned the trust of the people and you remained worthy of the trust, and if you're a woman, it becomes a plus factor. I've noticed it. Because I believe public perception, people trust a woman more because A, they think she's going to be more accessible, not demanding, not so much of acquisition oriented, communicative, caring. All these good qualities of the positive factor which are go with the woman goes with the powerful, and they actually make her more powerful. So I would think that anything, whether you're an entrepreneur or a professor or an administrator, if you groom yourself well, nurture yourself well, and then whoever you are, you stand up. And as a woman, you get even more greater respect because people feel more aligned with a woman. They feel she's one of us. They look at her as a mother. They look at her as a sister. They look at her as one of them, as a friend. Because the woman doesn't distance herself from the community. It's her nature to integrate. Woman's nature is to integrate, collaborate, and coordinate. That's her nature. And communicate. These are natural, second nature to every woman. Whereas these are called, in other parlance, called the soft skills. So some men, unfortunately, have to be trained in these soft skills. A woman is naturally born as a communicator. She's a born collaborator. She's a born connector. She's a born networker. Because mother networks. Woman communicates as a mother. So being a woman or a born a female, somewhere has an edge if you can build on it. And once you get professionally skilled also, qualified, you are a plus factor. You're not going to be trained. You just need honing of your professional skills. You see, if you look at Indira Nooyi's life, for me, I get very inspired from Indira Nooyi. Indira Nooyi added performance to purpose in her work as a PepsiCo CEO many years ago. For the first time, the CEO added purpose and performance, purpose to performance. And you see her whole menu on the shelf changed from aerated waters to also nutritious and healthy foods. Because this is where she gave purpose. A woman's nature, so is it a man. Not that, though I'm not making any, but I'm saying, since you've asked me about a woman, look, she is a brilliant example for all of us. And Indira Nooyi is a product of IMM Calcutta. She didn't go to IIT, but she went to IMM Calcutta. Then she went to Yale Administration School. But she added purpose to administration. Now, I also added purpose to anything I did. I added purpose to my Inspector General prison work. I added purpose to my Lieutenant Governor Puducherry work. What was the purpose? Purpose of public service. I grew up with a purpose in public administration, therefore it was so natural for me. So what I'm saying is, these are female very important qualities. Only challenge for her is, how does she manage multiple roles? How does she grow up to play multiple roles as she expands, as she grows in life? Because she becomes a mother, she becomes a wife, she becomes a daughter-in-law, and she remains a daughter. And she's also a CEO, she's also Inspector General, but she expands her roles. So therefore, that is the real bigger challenge for a woman in today, not otherwise, if she's groomed herself. But if she's groomed well, then she's also knowing how to handle multiple roles. But if she doesn't groom well, but she's only got professional qualifications, then she's in trouble. Then she is in trouble, because if she's not learned to create support systems, the certain support systems are also related with her presence, like a mother's presence. So she may be an IIT, she may be a CEO, I may be DGP of the police, I may be a director general, I may be inspector general, but I'm also a mother. What do I do? I'm a simple mother. That role cannot be delegated. So I think these are the challenges, but if you ask me as a woman, the moment she's nurtured herself well, she creates support system, she has an edge.
Yes, ma'am. So in your personal life, so what has been your make or break point in like your career? So like, and then from that point, how did you like come back stronger and what kept you going?
Well, one of my breakpoints did come very early in my career when I had, I became a mother and I had a 3-year-old daughter who needed constant medical care. She had a kidney ailment called nephrotic syndrome and she would retain fluids and every time we needed to see that she releases water because otherwise she fluffs up. Only from 3 years old and I was at the peak beginning of my career. And she needed constant care. Only choice I had was stay home and totally look after her or create support system, very credible support system. That's a time when my mother stepped in, my father stepped in, my family stepped in. So we became an extended family. We became a joint family. And my parents left their home in Amritsar, their own home, just locked it up and came to Delhi. And they are the ones, they worked on her from the age of 3 till the age of 13. She took 10 years to recover. And those were my peak career hours, years. So I was home and out of home, but my mother was at home. That's what I'm saying. I was truly blessed by such caring parents, such loving parents, where they sacrificed their own home to be with me in Delhi. But the best part is my mummy's home now was my home. And my daughter never had her eyes off. My mother never had the eyes off my daughter. She nursed her. She had to be homeschooled till her kidneys on her own recovered. By the time that was the pattern of disease she had. Some doctors did say that out of her nephrotic syndrome, some children grew out on their own. And she did at the age of 13, which had its own after effects. But the point here is I had only one choice. Either I stay home and all that I'd worked and aspired for in my personal nurturance, I would just put it aside, hang it and wait till she recovers. Or I get a family support which is more loving than me. So my daughter grew up with two mothers, not one mother. So two mothers. That's why I'm saying this support system is so critical in our working lives, that support systems, particularly for a working woman, she needs it. And I was very fortunate. My family stepped in and they loved it. And we also loved it because I used to be very fond of my parents and we could move in. Lovely. The best part is I had my husband who respected this equally. He respected the fact that we were now a home and my home was open to two mothers. My mother-in-law, anytime she wanted to come from Amritsar, or my mother, she was already with me. So they were not narrow-minded. It was, I think, the way I lived my life in the 70s, early 70s, I think was far ahead of its time as well. Just as my IPS was ahead of its time, so was the way I was a part of a family ahead of its time. Because the way my parents walked in, normally at that time, no parents lived with their daughters, no parent. I never not aware of, but my mother did, my father did. And so did my in-laws respect it. The question is, if they had not respected it, you think I would have let it go? No, I wouldn't. That way I was very strong-willed because what I was doing was the right thing, was needed. And that is the need of the hour. And that it was my need as well. And so I think this is very important to be strong and clear in the purpose. So I could provide my policing unbridled, full attention because I could need not have run back, but I ran back home whenever my mom said there's an emergency. So I came back home for emergency and I came back home not networking for dinners. I had to skip all these kinds of formal networking dinners. They were not my priority. My priority was finish my work and go home because my daughter's waiting for me. But if there's during the day an emergency, I was only one wireless message away, wireless, not phone calls. We never had these mobile phones. So I was on a wireless. कि घर से मैसेज आया, बात कर लो, बस सिर्फ ये मैसेज आया, वॉट एवर माई कॉल साइन वॉज, घर में बात कर लो. सो नाउ आई वुड रीच अ लैंडलाइन, कॉल माई मदर सेइंग मम्मी एनीथिंग अर्जेंट, शी इज़ बेटा अभी ये हुआ है, तो ठीक है मैं आती हूँ, अभी आती हूँ, या मम्मी इनको इन डॉक्टर के पास ले जाओ, ये डॉक्टर. सो आई वुड कनेक्ट माई मदर टू द डॉक्टर. सो यू नन ऑफ यू इन द वर्ल्ड नो दैट फ्रॉम द एज ऑफ 3 to her 13, 10 years of my prime career, how I managed both a recovering child and abundance of policing, which I gave my heart and soul to. So this is what our challenges are, and I have no sad memories of it. I'm just saying these are life challenges I lived up to, and why my mother and family supported me for the reason. They said, we have groomed you for this. We have trained you. We made you a tennis champion. We thought our daughter would. All we were four of us. We were not one. We were four girls in the house, and my parents were also very forward-looking and ahead of their time. So they also said, when we have made our daughters for this, then what are we? Why should we not continue strengthening our family? So they walked in. So it was so forward, broad-minded, modern-looking, even for current times. So that's the kind of environment I have been a product of, and that's what answers your question. How did?
Yes.
Yeah. Go ahead.
That is so true. And your story was really emotional, ma'am. Like it made I think people actually got inspired by that. So let us talk about your the long career, long illustrious career. So after taking charge as a police officer, after a few years, so you also plan to pursue law. So what made you, how did this come up? What made you do that?
Because I'm a learner at heart. I'm a very good student. I was a very good student. I loved academics, and I loved academics for the knowledge it gives you. Not to pass an exam. I've never, even as a school student, read my books to pass an examination. I used to do advanced learning. I remember when we were going to the next class in our school time, my mother used to get me my school bag of the next class during the summer vacations itself. So we would go to the bookshop called the Chopra Book House, and mommy would get me the fifth standard books when I was to go to the fifth standard after July when the schools would open. And I would read all my books during summer vacation. I was a reader of books. I used to read my English, history. I used to love liberal arts. So I was a story reader myself, very curious to know what's coming in my next book. So I was a student by love, academics by love, not before examinations. So therefore, law degree also came out of the love for continuing education in my service career. I just did not do a law as an IPS officer. I also did a PhD from IIT Delhi. I also did a postdoctoral work by getting a Nehru scholarship after my prison work to write a book on that work. So I'm a student at heart. I'm an absolute, every day I study, I learn and I read. If I don't read every day, I feel my brain's gone empty. I need to add something fresh and new. So if you remain a learner, and you continue to focus on subject which will upgrade your performance better. Doing a law degree helped me immensely in my administration, because I go straight to the law, I read the rule and apply. I don't wait for guidance. I say, tell me the rule and tell me the law. I go to the Bar Act, I go and read the rule, and I tell them that's a decision I take, because I have to follow the law. And I interpret the rule and I take my risks. So with the result that I'm faster in decision making, because I'm trained in reading law, I apply the rule, and nobody can question that then, because I know my law, I know my rule. Doing my PhD helped me in concise writing. So this is what happens.
Yes,
ma'am. Then you constantly upgrade your academic skills in entrepreneurship, upgrade your entrepreneurial skill, right? Your professional skill, your mechanical skill, your IT skill. It continues to nourish you and inspire you to do better and better.
So, ma'am, you've also held the... So, ma'am, what is your message for the young upcoming entrepreneurs and students of the country?
Well, if you would say, my one clear message is, look, I have reaped what I've sown. Remember the law of nature. You reap as you sow. You reap goodness. You sow goodness, you will reap goodness. You reap hard work, you will sow good results. You sow good hard work, you will reap success. It's bound to be. You don't have to seek it. Hard work cannot go waste. Good thinking cannot go waste. So you reap as you sow. You reap time, investment into whatever you do, you will reap it. Because you've sown it. If you sow nimbu pear, you will reap the lemons. If you sown a mango tree, you will reap mangoes. It depends when they ripen. Doesn't matter. Don't wait. Don't worry. But if you sown a mango seed, you will only get mangoes. But if you sown a good seed, you will get very good mangoes. And number two, if you've nurtured the seed, you've acted as a gardener of your life, you will bear better fruits. And you will enjoy the fruits. And you'll have so much that you will distribute. In life, this is what's happened. Today, I have so many fruits every day to distribute through these webinars. Tremendous fruits to distribute. Thanks, because I've sown hard work. You sow hard work, and you also did it through support systems. You respected them. So you distributed those hard. Even when I was getting all the credits which I was getting while in service, I distributed amongst my friends and family, gave them the credit, saying, because of them, because of the support system, I'm here where I am. So keep distributing. So my message would be, you must sow what you want to reap. You sow more, you reap more. You sow less, you reap more, reap less. But if you want to reap more, sow more, whether it's in family, whether it's in professional, whether it's in networking, whether it's in friends, whether it's in academics, everything needs this. And you need not just sow one and reap them. You can sow multiple, like a gardener. When he has a spring, he doesn't sow only one flower. He has so many flowers, and therefore he has a riot of color. That's why it's called spring. The spring of life comes with the kinds of seeds you sow. And if you've sown many, many seeds, you will reap a spring. Or you just see reap a rose with a thorn. But if you want more colors, then see sow more colors. So that's when you get a rainbow. So I would say my message would be that reap. You will sow as you reap, and reap as you sow. There is a law of nature which you cannot defy. So if you want to reap more, sow more. Add quality to the sowing. Add nutrition. Be a gardener of your own life. I would say be a gardener of your own life and work on a spring, not just one.
We have a few questions here from the audience. As a jail officer in Tihar Jail, do you have any interesting anecdote regarding any prisoners or any new situation you faced?
Purnima, you got to read a book called It's Always Possible. I've documented the whole work. It's a classic. It's translated into Italian languages and Spanish and others. It's a classic on the entire management transformation of the largest prison in the world. So if you want answers as IITians and you're looking for management and entrepreneurship, that's a book on social engineering. It's called It's Always Possible. It's full of anecdotes. In the end, there's a chapter by a Norwegian. He was in the jail for drugs, for 5 kilograms of heroin, 5 kilograms, according to the charge sheet of the courts. He was staying there. And we had meditation programs inside the prison. So he went for a meditation program called Vipassana meditation program. And in that Vipassana meditation, after he came out, he talked to his lawyer and he said, I want to be produced in the court. Please produce me. Gassner, his name was Leo Gassner. So he went to the court and told the court. The lawyer said, what do you want to say? He said, my lord, I want to admit my guilt. I have brought in heroin from Norway. I did. And therefore, but the truth is, that they were not 5 kgs. They were 10 kgs. I want to know where are the other 5. I brought 10 kgs, but the police is showing only 5 kgs. I want to know where are the other 5 kgs, but I want to admit. And the court said, don't you understand that this gives you life imprisonment? He said, yes, I do. But I want to set myself free. I don't want to live in the prison with the guilt. I want to be free inside, because he'd done the meditation program of Vipassana for 10 days of total silence. And he was setting himself free. He said, I want to get rid of this guilt. And then I want to adopt the prison programs, which were ongoing that at that time, and they're still ongoing. Then the judge said, well, they didn't know what to do. Where's the five other 5 kgs? It's his story. Is the last part of my book, It's Always Possible. And by the way, it's written in his own handwriting. Because when I was writing it, I was wondering, how would you believe it if he doesn't do it in his own handwriting? So the last chapter of the book, It's Always Possible, is by Leo Gasnier. But can you believe what happened to Leo Gasnier after that? His story was picked up by the television, by Norwegian television, and it got transmitted there. And the Norwegian government approached the... By the way, he was convicted. The court declared him convicted. Now, after you are convicted, you can be pardoned by the president. You can be transferred to another jail because his conviction was over. Because he admitted, the court said there's nothing more for trial. I convict you for life imprisonment. Finished. So his story of life imprisonment, that Norwegian being convicted, went up to the Oslo television. And Oslo television, his mother heard him on the television. His mother heard him. And the mother asked for help. So a mother brought friends together, asked for help. So Norwegians helped the mother fly to Delhi to meet Leo. But by that time, the Prime Minister of Norway was visiting India. So Prime Minister, by coincidence. So mother came because of the funds raised by Oslo and gave it to the mother. Then the Prime Minister of Norway was visiting. The Prime Minister of Norway requested the president to pardon him because of the transformation he'd gone through. And can you believe it? The Indian president pardoned him and he was transferred back to Oslo. And he went back as a free citizen to Oslo just because of that meditation program he did. This is a story he's written. This is a part of that book, last chapter. Read that. And once he went back to Oslo, he started to ship us a lot of warm clothing back to the foundation, to my India Vision Foundation, which works on prison reforms. They started to send warm clothing because he saw that many prisoners need a lot of warm clothing. So he became a donor. Can you believe it? It's all in the book. Go ahead and read. So you asked me a question, I'm giving you a whole package. Read the book. It's always possible.
So we have another. We'll be taking the last two questions, ma'am. So we have another question. Many civil service aspirants are apprehensive of the high amount of political pressure they might face in their work. So the person wants to know, how much of it is true? Do they actually face a lot of political pressure if they don't accept bribes? And then if any situation arises in which their higher authorities are in the wrong, so what should be their response? How should they, respond? Yeah.
Well, it's a fact that the civil servants face a lot of political pressure. It's a fact. And where the political leadership is of low quality, where it is, I'm not saying everywhere, but wherever the political leadership is a very low quality, higher the pressure. Where if it's good quality, they perform and they love performing. They enjoy the performance. But where it's for low quality and they exert negative political pressure, they do put the bureaucrats into a dilemma. Do they fall in line or do they not accept? Now, if they fall in line, they run the equal risk of later on bad decisions, because the politician disappears after 5 years. He may come to power, he may not come to power. But the bureaucrat has to earn his pension all his life. So if he is investigated by investigating agencies like CBI or the CAG audits, right? Or he gets exposed or vigilance inquiry, then he has to suffer it. But he takes a risk. because his performance appraisal is written by the political master. So if he does not get a good political appraisal, he's anyway in the bind because he won't get his promotion, next promotion. So the same minister who, of being of low political quality, is also the writer appraiser of his ACR. So what does this politician, the bureaucrat, do? Does he suffer a bad adverse ACR? Or falls in line, but suffer vigilance inquiry if there's a risk involved? So the bureaucrats are in a dilemma when it comes to political masters, where the political masters is of very low quality. And you know what means by low quality, which is unethical, which is only one point program is, how do I sell anything to get a vote? How do I sell anything? How do I decide anything which is only for a vote, not for public performance, not for larger public good? So help make the bureaucrat put up a note or fall in line. The bureaucrat is in a dilemma. Save his performance appraisal, but he will run the risk of vigilance inquiry or investigations later. Or face a transfer. Face a transfer. So these are three choices he has to make. It all depends on the personality of the person. Everybody is not courageous enough to take these risks of transfer. And they are afraid of the vigilance inquiry, but they're good for short-term gains, and therefore they suffer a lot of mental stress. This is a fact of life.
Yes. So for the final question, we have, ma'am, could you please tell us, how do you look back on your journey today, and what is one of your most proudest moments?
Look, I've lived my life fully lived. And I look, I'm 71 years old today. I just don't know how it's flown. It's been too short to do so much. Believe me, I have lived a very fulfilling life. I've lived every day of my life to the fullest by learning, by giving, by sharing, by doing, by playing, by reading, by exercising. I've had a lot of, it's been very blessed life. I've had my sorrows and joys, as I told you, from the age of 3 to 13. It was a very, very trying time of my career and my personal life. When it was, and then after that, 13, she's now a teenager. She's homeschooled and she has gone through so many challenges. It's not an ordinary challenge to then have a teenager suddenly become healthy, getting health back, and now wants to return to school, etc., and has very few friends. See, so I've gone through very challenging motherhood. But the good news is that we came out of it collectively and together. So I've lived my life that was not in my hands. When that problem attacked her, it was not in my hands, it was not called for, it just came. So this is what life is all about. So these challenges, they come and go. All you have to do is keep finding a way to deal with them. Challenges came in a very big way, legal challenges by the Honorable Chief Minister then of Haryana, politicians of Puducherry then. But we lived one by the day, and I succeeded because I've had a great teamwork. Just as I had family support during my policing, I had some remarkable teamwork in Puducherry, and that's why we used to call it Team Rajnivas, where everybody was a member of the team who was giving everybody its best because we worked as a family. Team Rajnivas became as large family where everybody contributed with love and trust and enjoyment. So if you ask me about my life, I think it's just flown. 71 years have just flown. I do not know what lies ahead. But all I can say is I am a very grateful liver of my life. Grateful to all who contributed to these 71 years of my journey, whether professional or personal.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for joining us. It has been like a real privilege to talk to you and listen. to you. I'm sure like the audience enjoyed it and of course gained a lot of experience. It was a learning experience. So ma'am, so this brings us to an end of the talk session, and I request Ramya to take upon for the further proceedings. So thank you all for joining us today.
Thank you, Purnima.
Thanks a lot. Thanks.
Thank you, Purnima. A speech full of motivation and inspiration. A voice full of energy and dynamism. When I listened to your speech, the picture of Dr. Kiran Bedi disappeared, and the image of enormous power, which has no physical and mental constraints, just occupied my heart and mind. We all have dreams, but in order to make dreams come into reality, it takes an awful lot of determination, dedication, self-discipline, and effort. We all salute to your never-dying spirit of enthusiasm, Dr. Kiran Bedi, ma'am, the first IPS officer of India. You are the role model for many young women in various fields. I extend my sincere thanks for your overwhelming speech. Namaste, ma'am.
And namaste. Now,